Fudgy sounds coming from Palm Desert, California. Josh came by the Sound Opinion Studio recently while he was on tour with the Queens of the Stone Age, and I started the conversation by asking him about his first band's legacy.
I'm so proud of that band, and it really took on a life. Its real life happened afterwards.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, in all honesty,
nobody cared when you were doing it,
especially in America. It was like even members of my family didn't care, you know. But I also think that it sort of galvanized our beliefs. You know,
mm-hmm.
I mean, we never had techs because you didn't do that. We're from the desert. We move our own gear. You know,
yeah.
Even when we were on a bus, we're like, no techs. We were kind of arrogant and we were way off base. But it made it something special.
Mm-hmm.
And the people that did get it got it so much so that they were the same as us. There was no separation between band and fan of the band, you know.
Well, you've often said growing up in Palm Desert, there was nothing but music. That was it. That was it for you. And so you could learn how to play and you could begin to create entirely on your own terms.
Well, we had a great record store called the Record Alley.
Mm.
And it was in the mall. So it wasn't like it was off the beaten track. But it was in the mall and they had a huge import section. You know, vinyls were $7, so you could afford to try. You know, I mean, the amount of times I bought a record just by cover alone.
Mm.
And then was totally bummed out, but it's still, but not all the time. It's not about the amount of swings. It's that one time that you really, you know, find something.
Right.
And socially, from the time I was old enough to go out, it always was about music. That's just what was already there for me, you know.
I'm impressed by the enterprise of that, though. 14, 15-year-old kids taking generators out to the desert and playing shows out there. I mean, that's not your typical...
Well, really, there was only one generator. There was one, and it was owned by a guy called Mario Lali, who everyone calls Boomer, and he really is responsible solely for being the SST bands played the desert, the only bands that play the desert. So that do-it-yourself, you really can atmosphere is contagious, and Boomer really embodied that. He had a generator. He'd have parties at his house. He would listen to Deep Purple, Black Flag, Swa, John Coltrane, you know, Motown stuff. And for him, everything was okay as long as it was good and as long as you were trying to be yourself. And so that rubbed off on me. And he was a big guy. He was about, you know, 400 pounds. And he would play guitar and he was he still is. He's such an original guitar player. And I remember watching him and thinking, he is unhecklable. You cannot like his stuff, but you don't say, this is fake.
What was the goal there? I mean, was it a case of just, we can't get shows at clubs or kids' basements, so we're just going to go out in the desert and play? Or was it something different than that?
You know, I think kids don't really have a long view for what's... I mean, it wasn't even that we couldn't get shows somewhere else. You just knew there wasn't the society in the desert... was like, there's no bands here. I'm sorry. We don't do that, you know. And the desert became just this natural, you know, in hindsight, why I really feel blessed to have been around that situation. It's got nothing to do with me. I just happen to be there because, you know, it seemed so natural to go, well, let's go out there then where we always go, where we're going to smoke pot and no one can see us or smoke cigarettes. And, you know, and you have these parties in this beautiful location. And sometimes there were 20 people, and sometimes there were 400 people. Sometimes they were so lawless, it was scary. And sometimes they were like a love fest, you know? And you never knew what you're going to get, and it made it different every time. I think I got addicted to that, too, that it has to be every situation is situational.
Mm.
And it's always nice to drive by police where their police crews are buried in the sand, you know? Stop and pull us out, you know? We'll be right back.
Well, all these years later, you still try to reconnect with that, with these desert sessions. I mean, what are we up to? 10? 20?
I haven't done one in quite some time, but not on purpose. But yeah, mm-hmm. we're up to 10.
Yeah. I read a great quote from you once about those. You know, you're getting people together to record as if, you know, we're starting on day one. And, you know, you said that it's necessary to do that sometimes just to make music again with no expectations and nothing but the joy of making music.
Yeah, for no reason. Hmm. You know, I, in all honesty, I don't really promote them. And it's more for the musicians in a way. And mm-hmm. I think it's also a really great treasure for somebody that is a music lover. They'll know that they're out there, you know. Mm-hmm. If you're in a band, Caius was so insulated, we couldn't play with anybody else. It would be like cheating on your girlfriend, you know? And there were so many rules in Caius that we made that it became tough to not break them on accident. But with Desert Sessions, it's like saying, you know, I'm not saying break up with your band. I'm saying come here, do this, and be something that you never would have been in your other band just for no reason at all.
You were what, 22 when Caius ended?
21.
What did you feel at that point?
You know, I mean, I always thought the shows were getting bigger in Europe, and I always thought, well, someone's just going to take this all away because isn't that what happens? You know, I think it was a bit of a punk rock guilt mixed with a defeatist attitude, like the best music never gets heard, man. It's there's some kind of safety there. And to be honest, I felt like Caius was the goal would be to have a band, but not too long before you changed and turned it into something else. That you should kind of, to preserve it is to destroy it.
So there was never any consideration of, well, now it's time to become a contractor like my dad.
Well, no, I assumed that that's what would happen. And really, I didn't listen to that much music because, you know, you're a kid and you sort of like, I listen to Black Flag and the English Subhumans, and that's what I listen to, and don't try. And people would say, you guys sound like Sabbath. And I loved being able to say, I've never heard Sabbath.
Was an interesting band because you said there's no category, we couldn't play with others. I mean, you got lumped in with Stoner Rock kind of after the fact, you know, that.
Well, that term was almost more for Judas. Like, I remember being in high school and the Stoners were, they listened to Priest and Maiden. And so when people started calling a Stoner Rock and this genre of stuff, you know, I was offended. Mm-hmm. Because I was like, no, we're Black Flag. You know, at the end of Black Flag, they sounded more jazzy than ever.
Yeah.
And so I took that, whatever is going on out there, just don't do that.
But the sound was immense. I remember seeing a show near the end of it. I wrote something like widescreen. It was kind of like it didn't feel vertical. It felt horizontal. I don't know a better way to put it.
No, but that's exactly it, because when you play outside, it's not bouncing off anything. It's got a way of sounding tiny instantaneously. And I remember, you know, trying to figure out what could make us different. What could be us? What could be me? You know? And I didn't have a tuner. And so I just started going down and I went till the strings flapped and then I just went up a bit. And that's how we tuned to each other. And the magic coincidence of it was that outside, all of a sudden, we were heavier than everybody. And so we started, you know, I started playing bass amps for guitar and started just going down that road of, well, what else are you not supposed to do or that's wrong? Mm-hmm. Let's just do, you know, if two wrongs don't make a right, but what if 50 wrongs make?
Do you understand why the influence sort of grew after the fact? I mean, do you have an appreciation for that now? Or?
Absolutely. I mean, it's such a rare thing to have a legacy. You can't try to make that happen. And if we'd have kept going, it wouldn't have happened the same way, too.
I got to ask you, too, before Queens got going, there was a brief period there where you got involved with Screaming Trees, and which was a great thing. It was, we loved that band.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And those,
I think,
brothers.
They played a gig at EMP when it opened, and you were the second guitarist in the band.
Right.
So it almost seemed like the only reason that band held together was because you were trying to keep it together at some point.
I'd quit playing music, and I just, you know, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I was going to school in Seattle. My brother lived up there, and my friend Mike Johnson, he suggested me, and frankly, I hadn't heard the Trees at that point. And I heard one song, I heard Lanigan's voice, and I said, yeah, anyone that does know me would think I shouldn't do this, so I'll do that. And it was just for one tour, Lollapalooza tour. And they didn't get along. They didn't hate each other, but they didn't really get along all the time. They would say terrible stuff to each other, but I got along with all of them, and I was much younger than they were, you know, 6 or 7 years, and so I kind of became like a youth pastor. But it was great experience. Being a hired gun was really wonderful experience, and I remember I was driving, the Ramones were on that Lollapalooza tour, and I was driving C.J. Ramone's truck, and I'm driving in the middle of nowhere thinking, how could I not play music for a living in this, you know, we were in the desert going to New Mexico, and it's like, how could I give this up to, like, go to school for business?
Wow, so that's how that was the moment where you kind of thought, let's keep doing some things.
Yeah, I'd be foolish not to see where this road goes.
We'll talk more about where Josh Homme's road has gone after a short break here on Sound Opinions from WBEZ Chicago and PRX. And later, we review the new album from Superchunk, and I'll drop a quarter into the Desert Island Jukebox.
Sound Opinions is supported by Shutterstock.com. With over 26 million high-quality images, you'll find the perfect one for your next creative project. Shutterstock sources images from around the world and provides flexible pricing, sophisticated search tools, and professional quality images for your own music website, blog, or video. You can try Shutterstock for free today. Just sign up for a free account, and once you decide to purchase, use the offer code SOUNDOPINIONS8 to get 30% off any package. That's SOUNDOPINIONS8 for 30% off at Shutterstock.com. Welcome back to Sound Opinions. I'm Greg Kot with Jim DeRogatis, and our guest this week is Josh Homme, lead singer of Queens of the Stone Age. We talked before the break about Josh's first band, Caius, one that helped define that stoner rock genre. After Caius ended in 1995, Josh started up Queens, and it was a very different band. As we pick up our conversation, Josh Homme explains where the Queens of the Stone Age sound came from.
I've always wanted to make something that someone within a couple seconds would hopefully know it's you. I didn't really want to sing, but I tried to work with some people, and they were all singers. It's hard to find people to exchange ideas with that aren't afraid. So I had kind of a full band, and 2 days before we were going to go to the desert and make the first record, I just let everyone go except the drummer, and I guess I'll try to sing.
Well, if we look at the history, Josh, of Queens from 97 to the present, you're the sole constant. Was that part of your plan from the beginning, is with this group, I'm going to call it a group, but I'm going to always be tossing things up?
Well, in any situation, you want to be appreciated and you want to show appreciation. But I think for music, a democracy is not necessarily the way to get the best thing, you know? I mean, this is about sort of chasing the sounds in your head. And like Queens has always been run by consensus where we talk about what we're going to do. But it's also, in some ways, it's a consensus, but then it's not a democracy either, you know?
You get to be the dictator at the end of the
day.
Well,
I mean, I wanted to make a world where, my own world that I could live in. But at the same time, I want to be a good listener. I want to work with you. I want to listen to what you have to say. And I want to be able to be honest and say, I'm just not that into that.
I want to explore this dictator thing just a little bit deeper, because there's no such thing as, man, that's not a dictatorship. Even if you look at some of the classic examples that seemed like a partnership, Lennon and McCartney. But really, like, McCartney would be ascendant on one record and Lennon was in the background and, you know, on Revolver.
But it created this great, even if it's an undercurrent, this great competition of the worst thing you could have is role envy if you want to be the bass player and you're the drummer. Mm-hmm. And really, I've seen in so many bands over the years where it's like, why don't you just say what you want and stop living with this like thing where you, I wish we could do that, as if someone were stopping you.
Right. Do it.
And that's what I love about Queens is that whenever I've worked with someone new, it's always, look, you be yourself. One of the things you have to do is speak your mind and say what you really think. But I'd love to be in something where we're all working in the same direction. And you're not spending time and energy like stopping someone's passive aggressive behavior.
Yeah, right. You get tired of that after a certain point.
Yeah, because who cares? Just shut up and say what you want. Let's try to get awesome. Let's try to do something classic.
Yeah.
You mentioned the voice earlier, and I want to touch on that because I remember when people were sort of putting you in the hard rock end of things. We just talked a little bit about Ozfest before we started taping here, and you were on Ozfest, I believe, like 2000 or so, sometime very early in the band's career, before anybody really knew who you were. And out comes this guy who's 6'6 and looks like he's, you know, could chop down a tree with one hand, and singing in a fairly high voice, not your traditional growly subterranean metal voice, and this kind of eclectic music going on. What was going through your head? Was it just to sort of screw with people? I'm just going to be the singer because nobody's expecting this, or was there something else going on?
Well, I mean, there's a few things. One is I can't scream. I sound like I'm asking someone to prom. I'm like, it just doesn't sound good. And also, that's not my style. I like the juxtaposition of something broken with something beautiful growing out of it, you know? And I also, for me, I finally started to realize the goal is to be able to play any type of music you want, and it just goes through your filter, but you make it work. You make it okay. And I also don't want to play to just a bunch of guys either. I want it to be like the parties I grew up going to, where it was kind of wild and chaotic, and it was boys and girls, and it was loose. And it was, the sun is down and it's the weekend and anything is possible. That I grew up romanticizing that and live in that environment. And I just feel like if you get to do this, you should take that chance. Yeah, they didn't like us very much on Ozfest. But see, I was in Kai, so I was used to being hated. And I've always enjoyed a little of friction and a little confrontation. like that, because you must be doing something right if it's angering somebody.
And not sticking with the sound either. I mean, those, you go from the Queens of the Stone Age record in 98, Rated R in 2000, sounded different from that. Songs for the Deaf sounded different from that. People say, well, what's the Queens of the Stone Age sound? And I don't think anybody could have ever put their finger on, other than you being a common thread through the whole thing. Was that intentional?
Kaius had a singular sound. In a lot of ways, when it was time to come back and I said, okay, I'm going to do my own thing, and in a lot of ways, all I did was look at what I felt worked for Kaius, and I thought, well, maybe the polar opposite of that will work. And I wanted a way to play music like my taste was, you know, Slayer, Sinatra, Motown, you know, Little Richard. Because I felt like, oh, this is how people really listen to music. It's all over the place, whatever's good. So I kind of had this three-record plan of, you know, taking three records to fan out this music. And the goal would be to, you know, take people that were into you slowly on this journey where you could play anything and they would accept it.
Choosing people too to play with, you know?
Well, at the end of the day, you play with the best people you have available to you.
But when you have the sound in mind, you sort of say, you know, it would be great to have this guy for this record or for this song. Or was it
just more...
You
mean having guests and stuff like that? Well, I always expect those creative relationships not to last because they're sort of designed not to in a lot of ways, you know? And early on, I really wanted to harness something that should destroy itself. You know, hence having Nick and Mark and me, and it was a tough group to tour manage.
Well, I was going to ask about Nick Oliveri. I mean, the closest you've had to a foil through Queens of the Stone Age was Oliveri. And you know, when he left, a lot of people who'd even – listeners who were willing to go on this journey as you changed through those first couple of albums, you know, were like, they've lost something. That's it. I'm out.
Yeah. I mean, it was a tough time because it wasn't about music. And it wasn't about partying. It was about something that was rough and where I had to make a choice. And I've known Nick since I was 11, and I love Nick. And I thought to myself, I always kept my personal life really far away. I didn't want people to know about me personally, you know. And we were doing well, but that's dangerous. There's no amount of advice that can help you out when you're starting to do well, how you handle it. So I had to turn and fire my best friend, you know. Mm. And I here I was thinking, like, I'm not going to say why because it could be really damaging for him, but I'm going to drive to his house, look him in the eye, and do it like I've done before. Because, and I kept thinking, people will understand, they'll respect that, and as if they would know, and as if that really is how it goes, you know. So I was really confused because it completely exploded the dynamic of where the band was going. But it had to be done, you know. It had to be done. You know, people were like, fired both the other singers. And I remember people would say to me, like, you want to sing more. Where I thought, oh, my God, are you serious? Yeah. So for a sec, it sort of messed with my head for a sec, you know.
Yeah.
When the fact of the matter is that 3 months after I let Nick go, we were having drinks together and hanging out and, you know, repairing what got damaged. Don't blink. She called me baby and it wasn't me.
I want to jump ahead to one of your side projects. I'm fascinated by the concept of the conversations with John Paul Jones and Grohl. You know, Dave Grohl, having been through Nirvana, the band of a generation, that famous, and then the end, you know, and, you know, John Paul Jones of the Vikings that crossed the world, right?
Yeah.
You know, were there insights that you gleaned from those guys in Them Crooked Vultures about how to handle oneself and keep creative and stay alive and deal with rock stardom, whatever that means?
Well, for starters, but even way before Vultures, you know, I've learned a lot from Dave. Dave and I have always had a real special relationship and chemistry together. And Dave is a very famous dude, but nobody handles it better than him. He's always handled it so well. And also always been just a nice guy.